and I'm touring outside of our beloved country, I would love to meet artists from different parts that of the Middle East, the crazy Middle East that you cannot meet.
So Dan, you're here in Zurich for promoting your album At the Edge of the Beginning. So we're going to start right at the beginning.
Yes.
At the age of 9, you started playing a musical instrument, the accordion.
Yes, the non-coolest instrument ever.
Was that your choice?
My mom's.
I thought it might have been. Did you always know that you wanted to get into music?
Yeah. I think that if you go to the beginning, I guess it started not at 9, but when I was born. Because they always ask me, how long have you worked on your album? So I always say that on your third album, you work since you finished your second one. On your second one, you work since you finished your first one. On your first album, you're working actually since the day you were born. Because it starts from the first lullaby that you heard
yes.
as a baby, and then it's just evolved during these until your first album.
And you can just portray it all into one.
Indeed.
One piece. And you were part of the Israel Defense Forces, and you would go from base to base performing.
Many years after, when I was 18 in yeah. Israel, Army service is a mandatory service. And we're serving, the men serve for 3 years, the women are serving for 2.5 years. You're serving your country. I was lucky to serve as a musician. And we had a band, a five-piece band, and we traveled from every evening from one base to another, or at the borders, or in hospitals, and it's
amazing.
And I played for 3 years. I learned a lot. Soldiers are the most honest audience after kids, because they definitely tell you what they think about the concert.
Your music's very peaceful. Did you think it kind of stemmed from the audience you're performing to at that time?
It's very peaceful because it brings a message of building bridges between cultures. First of all, in our inner society, you know, immigrants, we were the first to bring the voices of the immigrants, of the minorities, to the mainstream. The first time that in Israel the formal language is Hebrew, but the whole idea is that is every 10 or 15 years there is a new immigration that changed the face of the Israeli society, from kitchen to music. So, but you never heard when I was a child, you never heard on the radio the African languages, the Spanish. You would hear it on a world music niche radio stations. I think this is the main change that we did at the past 12 years, that we brought the voices of the minorities or the voices of the Israeli street to the Israeli mainstream. Just to compare, if I would tell you that there is a band in central Manhattan, that it's a band with immigrants from different parts of the world, and they're singing in Cantonese or Arabic, and I will tell you it beats the charts. It leads Beyonce and Rihanna back.
Yes.
You would say, no way. It's like probably being played on a world music radio station. This is the main change that we did in the conception of what they play in the Israeli radio. We brought the voices of the people on the streets of Israel.
Absolutely. And I saw a screenshot on your Instagram of The day your album was released, you were number one of the charts, and you were beating artists such as Adele, Justin Bieber.
In Israel, the iTunes in Israel, this was crazy. The same week, four albums were released: my album, Adele, Justin Bieber, and Coldplay. And for a while, it was like on the Israeli iTunes, we were number one. I said, wow, we got a huge hug from the Israeli media. And the Israeli audience. So it was a huge hug from the audience.
And you must have always felt the love from the people, but was that a point where you suddenly stopped and was like, wow, people are really listening to this, and you've suddenly...
It started many years ago, 10 years ago, when I turned on the radio, kind of prime time radio, and I heard our songs in Amharic from Ethiopia, the Moroccan tongue, Arabic, Yemenite dialects. When I heard our song being played on the prime time main hours, you know, of the Israeli, then I thought, wow, it's really happening. It's happening beautiful.
And you've collaborated with some amazing artists. Alicia Keys in 2014, that was an amazing performance. So who was the favorite artist that you've collaborated with?
Till today, I've collaborated with over 150 artists, musicians,
amazing,
and singers. The youngest is 16.
Wow.
And the young spirits are 83 and 91 years old.
Wow.
Some of them are very known, as Alicia Keys, or the greatest countertenor opera singer in the world, Andreas Scholl, or Patrick Bruel, the greatest singer from France.
Pourquoi ne pas y croire? Pourquoi ne pas se le dire? Faire avancer l'histoire et ensemble l'écrire. Je dirai tes poèmes, je chanterai tes chansons, il peindrait tes je t'aime sur toutes les maisons. L'âme chez nous dio ma chère, ma comista vez man y fait yoter, le chanot ou le cabé.
Viefa Kature from Mali, really people from India, of course, Grammy Award winning India Ari, and it was, but also people that it was their first time to come to the studio. At the end of the day, when what I love is that there is something that connect everyone, that it's just amazing people. Just amazing people, amazing human being. When I sat with, there is actually, after breaking the first excitement, there is no different than to sit with Alicia Keys as a friend, mm-hmm, and with 21 years old musicians that just came now from Argentina. It's just the humanity of the people, I think, that speaks and vibrates at the monitors in the studio.
So the Times had called you a one-man Middle East Accord. That's a very interesting statement. So do you think you have an obligation, because you are from Israel, to have a voice for the people from where you're from? And how does it portray in your music?
So because there are musicians that they are carrying on their shoulders the place that they are coming from. It can be, as I said, Edith Piaf from France, she's French, or Bob Marley from Jamaica. There are singers who are not, like Leonard Cohen from Canada. You don't hear on the monitors that he's from Canada, or Patch of Boys. It's not like you hear UK. It's so I'm Israeli, this is who I am, and this is the essence of, before I'm a musician, before even I'm Jewish, it's like I'm Israeli by definition. I was born in Israel, and my parents were born in Israel, and one of my grandfathers were born in Israel. We grew up to this beautiful country that is in a continuous conflict all over. The thing that I was shocked to understand around 10 years ago, when I was already old enough and on the road that we were not raised or educated to know anything about what's going on across the border, about the life of the people. I don't think that kids in Israel know enough about folk dancing in Lebanon, about the film industry in Syria. They don't know any Palestinian singer. I don't think that kids in Syria knows about the film industry in Israel. Kids in Iran definitely don't know anything about Israeli singing. So when you ask people, do you want peace? They will tell you, yes, of course. And you ask them, why you want peace? So they will probably tell you, because I don't want war. So when you say, so if I tell you that there is no war, there are no missiles, no nothing, do you still want peace? So they will say, no, so it's peace. So people have this misconception that war is the opposite of peace. But the opposite of war situation is a no-war situation. It got nothing to do with peace. Peace is the not only the borders to be open, but the will of the people to cross the border, to explore, to go to your favorite place that you read about in Damascus or in Tehran or in Tel Aviv. And I think that this is the thing that I would love to promote also in Israel, that kids will get interested. Definitely these days, they don't have any excuse. Just go online, everything is there. You know, just Google about everything that is across the borders. And when I'm touring outside of our beloved country, I would love to meet artists from different parts that of the Middle East, a crazy Middle East that you cannot meet. You know, when I played with Alicia Keys in Central Park, New York, I collaborate there with Ali Amr. Ali Amr lives 45 minutes from my house, and I cannot meet him. The border is closed.
Really? And that's a drive away, so that's a 45-minute drive.
If everything was open, 45 minutes I would be in his house. And I met him 30 years after in New York.
Some believe it's right to say Jesus when you pray. Some believe Muhammad, Allah, or Buddha are the way. Is there no God or a pantheon of gods up in the sky? I'll honor your choices and you can honor mine. Whether you are red, black,
so, talking about politics, these are the things that I'm very interested and moved by. And this also connects to the BDS movement when they ask to boycott Israeli artists. This is why I think that it's really going to the wrong direction, because if you mute the voices of the artists, you're actually muting the option to create any kind of a dialogue outside of our borders. If someone, promoter, will boycott our voice, how can we speak out and how can we create a dialogue?
So how is this album different now that you've found love, you've found a family? Is that portrayed in the music of your new album?
I came back to record at the basement of my parents' house. This house is a beautiful house. My parents are together since they're four.
Wow.
Yes. They went to kindergarten together. The grandmothers used to babysit each other. Mm-hmm. The whole neighborhood, all the parents know each other since they're four or since they're six. It was a very, very little town. Today it's a big city, and there were only a few families. So my parents are many, many, decades together, and there are since four, which brings out the question, if it's a true love or there were not many options, right, the city, but there are them for many years together. And I got back to the basement of my parents' house for a few reasons. One is that I grew up in this basement. It was kind of a kid's room that we played a lot, and then we started music there. And I put up the studio, which I recorded my first and my second album. I recorded in this basement when I was like in my 20s. Getting back there now, with the perspective of being a father, going back though, it was kind of a edge of the beginning of kind of a circle in life to go back there and to record there. All my songs are coming from my inner world, even songs that I recorded in the past. But the idea in the Dan Reichel project that in every song you'll find different lead singer and different musicians. I'm not the lead singer, I'm leading the band, but I'm not the lead singer. And you'll find singers from Africa, from Europe, from US, from South America, really from all over. Here and there I'm singing one or two songs. And all my songs are personal. On this last 2 years, I felt that the songs are actually, I'm singing about my daughter. I'm singing something that I want her to listen. Now, even if it's not saying, oh, you, my daughter, my da-da-da. No, just the thing, messages that I wanted to speak out in my own voice, physically in my own voice. Therefore, I started singing more and more and more and more songs. When I finished it, I felt that it sounds to me like a solo album, not as the Idan Reichel big project, but more of welcoming the listener to my inner world, to kind of a living room. I used to also live in this studio for many years. So
it really is a full circle that you've done to write it there. And did it come quite naturally to you writing something that was so different from your previous work?
Yes, indeed. Yeah. It came naturally. I think that all my albums have kind of a documentary feeling or autobiography feeling.
And it has a story behind. So what's the story behind, if there was a story that you had to tell, to summarise maybe one of the particular songs, a favourite song that you may have on the album, what story is that?
I feel that every song has a DNA, kind of a one line that the songs, that if you delete all the choruses, all the verses, if you stay with one sentence, this will be the DNA of the song. It can be also a DNA for an album. I feel that the last song in the album, it's very difficult for me to translate it to English because when I write the lyrics in Hebrew, and the metaphors or whatever I'm writing is very difficult for me to translate it literally or poetically. But it's the feeling of to find in this crazy run, to find moments that we can hold, lean on, something that you feel that you arrived. I feel that the past years, you know, when everything is like YouTube shuffled very fast, da 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 da, you wake up, you don't even your memory, you don't remember numbers anymore, you don't remember your schedule, if you don't have internet, you feel lost. And then just to stop the run and to feel that you arrived, there's something to hold. Everything is on iCloud, Dropbox, Google Drive, just something to hold, the touch, a human touch to something.
Just to hold on to and to steady you for a second.
Yeah, so the last song is really about that, and I feel that it's end the circle of the whole album.
Well, Idan, it was a pleasure to meet you. Thank you
pleasure
so much for coming
to meet you.
In.
It was a really good one. Thank you.
Thank you.
Ciao.